Welcome to the voice of one crying in the wilderness. This ministry is founded on Mark 1:3. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. After seeking the Lord in prayer, our name was given to us by the Lord. We invite you to like us on Facebook, The Voice Crying in the Wilderness, where you can, download all of our messages, or you may email us at a voice of one crying, and that would be avooc2019@gmail.com, where you can request a message to be emailed to you. You must know the speaker's name, day, and date. And our speaker for this evening is Pastor Akeem Brett. And his ministry is Present to Heal. At this time, we welcome you to the call, Pastor Brett. And we turn everything over to you for our opening prayer and our evening message. Pastor Brett.
All right. Good evening, everyone. It's a blessing to be back on this prayer line. I hope everyone is doing well by the grace of God. And I pray that we all have open hearts and minds to study God's word together. It is my prayer that the Holy Spirit will attend our study this evening and deepen our experience with Jesus Christ as we near the second coming and also the close of probation. It is my prayer that all of us will be found ready to meet Jesus when he comes. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. I thank you all for your patience on this prayer line. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, again for gracing us with an opportunity to study your words. Father, help us to treasure thy word in our heart. For the Bible says, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Grant us all that experience that as we study your words that we will be transformed, that by beholding we may become changed. We thank you for hearing and answering our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Again, I want to thank you all for your patience on this prayer line, and we're going to let the Holy Spirit speak to us through the Word. If you have your Bible, we're going to look at the topic. We're going to be studying the topic of finishing the work. Finishing the work. I know that that is a very common topic among Seventh-day Adventists. We want to see this work finished so that we can see Jesus come in the clouds. And the Bible says in the book of Matthew chapter 24, let's go there and begin in verse 14. Matthew 24 and verse 14, that before Jesus comes, the gospel must be preached in all the world, and then shall the end come. So before Jesus comes, this work of the gospel, this work of bringing souls to Christ, and this work of Christ being formed in the human heart must be completely finished before Christ comes. The Bible says in Matthew 24 and verse 14, and I'll read it, the Bible says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And then the Bible says, and then shall the end come. So the Bible speaks of the gospel being preached in all the world. And we know that this gospel is the three angels' message. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 14, verse 6, verse 7, it says, and I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, saying with loud voice, fear God, give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made the heaven, the earth, the sea, the fountains of waters. Then the second angel's message talks about Babylon's fall. The third angel's message talks about the mark of the beast, the reception of the beast, the worship of this image, which the Bible warns against. And then we see the people that the Lord has finished his work inside of them. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 14, verse 12, which we all know, it says, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God. The work of Christ has been finished in their hearts. The work of the Holy Spirit has been finished in their hearts. And the Bible says, here are they that keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. So before Jesus comes, the gospel must be preached in all the world, and God's work in the human heart will be finished. And the reason why we must focus on the finishing of this work is because I believe with all my heart that Christ is going to finish his work, and he's going to cut it short in righteousness. Many of us think that we have time to get ready, time to get right with God, but our time is wrapping up. Our time is almost finished. When we look at the news and we see all the things that are taking place in the politics, all the things that are taking place with climate change, all the things that are taking place with the mass shootings taking place, when we look at all the things that are taking place with the changing of laws, I'm talking about LGBT and all these things that are taking place, the changes of how God views marriage. The world is accepting now a false understanding of marriage. And when they knock down one of God's institutions, very soon they're going to knock down the second one, which is a Sabbath. And we're seeing very clearly that the world is an apostasy. The world, the cup of iniquity is almost full. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be in these last days. In the days of Noah, they were marrying and giving in marriage, a sign that we're living in the last days. Also, in the days of Lot, so shall it be also in the coming of the Son of Man when Christ comes, according to Luke chapter 17. And how was it in the days of Lot? The same conditions were seen, Sodom and Gomorrah, same-sex marriage, same-sex union. And these things will bring about Jesus' second coming. These things will bring about the close of probation. And the Bible says that God's going to cut his work short in righteousness. God is going to cut his work short because the Bible lets us know that unless he cuts the work short, no one could be saved. We're in Matthew 24. Look at it carefully. Matthew chapter 24. And the Bible says in Matthew chapter 24, and notice what the Bible says. Matthew 24, and let's look at verse number 8. The Bible says, Matthew 24, and verse 8, it says, all these things are the beginning of sorrows. All these things, all these signs that we're talking about, are the beginning of sorrows. And the Bible goes on to say, they shall deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and you shall be hated for all nations for my name's sake. We know that time is very soon to come. And let's skip on down to verse 22. Verse 22, it says, and except those days should be shortened. So God's going to shorten, finish his word. Except those days shall be shortened, there shall no flesh be saved. It says, but the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. And so, brothers and sisters, we must believe that God's going to shorten his work. He's going to finish his work. And those that are surrendering to him daily, those that are striving to overcome sin, those that are putting away sin, asking God to help them to learn how to abide in Christ, Christ will not only finish his work in their hearts, but Christ will allow them, by the grace of God, through the Holy Spirit being outpoured, and these last days, as we study and pray and consecrate our lives to the Lord, deepened by the Holy Spirit of God, our repentance, are saved. Our love for Christ, as the Holy Spirit has set abroad in our hearts, then Christ can begin to finish this work and cut it short in righteousness. Let's go in our Bible now to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 7. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. And the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 that time is short. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. And notice what the Bible says. We're going in our Bible to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 7. And notice what the Bible says in verse 29. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 29. I just want to focus on the first few sentences here. In 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 29, it says, "But this I say, brethren, the time is short." The Bible says, "This I say, brethren, the time is short." And we know that because time is so short, the devil, according to Revelation chapter 12, he's coming down to us having great wrath because he knows that he has a short time. And so because time is short, the devil is working overtime. And that's why it's so hard for us to spend time in the Word of God without either falling asleep, without us being distracted by the allurements and the amusements of Satan in these last days. That's why it's so hard for us when we go to church to hear messages that prepare us for the coming of Jesus, is because the devil is doing his best to keep us asleep a little bit longer because he knows how short time is. So the Bible says time is short. The Bible says the devil knows that we have a short time. And so this is the time that we must wake up. Probation is fast closing. And Christ is preparing a people that he will finish the work inside of their hearts by the grace of God and cut this work short in righteousness. Let's go on our Bible now to the book of Romans. Romans chapter 9. Romans chapter 9. The Bible says in the book of Romans, Romans chapter 9, and notice what it says. It's after the book of Acts, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans. Romans chapter 9. The Bible says these words very plainly in the book of Romans. Romans chapter 9, verse 28, the Bible says, He will finish the work and cut it short in righteousness, because a short work will the Lord make upon the earth. The Bible says, He will finish the work. Christ is going to finish this work. He is going to cut it short in righteousness. Why is it that we're acting as if we have much time when the Bible says that time is short? Why is it that we're acting that we have time to get right with the Lord when the Bible says that God's going to cut his work short in righteousness? So, brothers and sisters, the Bible says we must know the time. We must understand the times which we're living in and prepare for the soon return of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. There is a work that God would have us to do. There's a life that God would have us to live. There is a hope that God wants us to have as we see Christ coming. That's what the Bible talks about, the blessed hope. As we prepare for Christ's coming, God wants us to be engaged in spiritual warfare of praying, surrendering the heart, yielding to Christ, learning how to surrender to Christ. I would even consider going through the book Steps to Christ, because that book shows us how to get closer to the Lord. As the Lord is finishing his work in righteousness, the work must be finished in our hearts. Christ must finish his work in our hearts. And notice what the Bible goes on to say. It says in Romans 8, verse 28 and verse 29, it says, "For he will finish the work, and he will cut it short in righteousness." So the Bible says he will finish the work, and he will cut it short in righteousness. Now notice what the Bible says in the next verse, in verse 29. Because many people think that the way that God is going to finish the work is through different means or different ways. But we're going to see exactly today how God is going to finish his work. In verse number 29, the Bible says, in Romans chapter 9, verse 29, it says, As Isaiah said before, "Except the Lord of the Sabbath had left us a seed, we had been as Sodom, and we had been like unto Gomorrah." So it quotes Isaiah. So we have to go to the book of Isaiah to see how Christ is going to finish the work. We need to go to the book of who? Isaiah. It's interesting that when Jesus was preaching to the Jews of his day in Luke chapter 4, he opened to the book of Isaiah. He opened to the book of Isaiah, and he showed them, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He anointed me to preach the gospel," and he explained his mission to the Jews, and he was explaining his work. So to see how Christ is going to finish his work, let's go to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 61. Let's go there. Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 1.
We're going to the book of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 61. How is Christ going to finish this work? The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 1. Isaiah 61 and verse 1. We just read what the Bible says, that God is going to finish his work and cut it short in righteousness. Now the Bible says in Isaiah 61 and verse 1, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach the good tidings unto the meek. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty, freedom to the captives, and the opening of the prisons to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, the day of vengeance of our God. It says, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint, notice verse 3 now, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, and to give them beauty for ashes, righteousness by faith, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called the trees of righteousness. Then we read where the Bible says he's going to finish his work and cut it short in righteousness, that they may be called the trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that they might be, that he might be glorified. Now notice verse number 11. The Bible says, for as the earth bringeth forth her bud, and the garden causeth the things that are sown in it to spring forth, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all the nations. So the Bible says that God's going to finish his work and cut it short in righteousness through the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. If we receive the Holy Spirit, if we repent from sin, turn away from sin, confess sin, forsake sin, and believe in the atoning sacrifice of Christ, and believe in his work in the sanctuary, Christ can impart to us the power of the Holy Spirit. And the Bible says we would prophesy, we would be preaching, we'd be prophesying, we would be doing the work in these last days. And the Bible says that we would preach the gospel, we would be helping those that are in prison, we'd be setting the captives free through the power of the Holy Spirit. And let's go to Isaiah chapter 40, since we're in Isaiah. We see this work being done not just by Jesus alone, but we see this work being done through the forerunner who prepared for Christ's first advent, which was John the Baptist. And we are to do the work of John the Baptist. We are to do the work of, I like this prayer line name, of a voice crying in the wilderness. We are to be the one to point others to Jesus, and also to show that we are living right before his second advent. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 40 and verse number 3, the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 40 and verse number 3, it says, the voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. It says, every valley shall be exalted, every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain, and the glory, the character of the Lord, shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. It says, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. So here we see a prophecy which pointed to John the Baptist. He was in the wilderness. He was making straight the way of the Lord. He was preparing for Jesus to come, the first advent. He was a voice crying out in the wilderness. And brothers and sisters, for Christ to finish this work, we need more John the Baptists in our day. We need more workers in the field of Christ. We need more consecrated, dedicated soldiers in the army of the Lord. We need more surrendered hearts so that the Holy Spirit can be poured out in these hearts and minds, and to give us the message for this time. And the reason why I want to emphasize this is because the Bible lets us know that John the Baptist's ministry was rejected by the church. John the Baptist's ministry was not recognized by the scribes and the Pharisees. John the Baptist's ministry was a ministry that did not get the sanction. It did not get the approval of men. It did not get the approval of his then church. As a matter of fact, when the scribes and Pharisees came to John the Baptist's ministry, the Bible says that they came and John called them generation of vipers who warned you to flee from the wrath to come. They did not come because they were convicted of sin. They did not come because they wanted to give their hearts to Christ. they came because they wanted to stop the work of John the Baptist. But brothers and sisters, this work will finish by individuals filled with the power of the Holy Spirit and go forth and do the work of the Lord. And brothers and sisters, those who are receiving the unction of the Holy Spirit in these last days, they will be unified. And why do I say that? Because brothers and sisters, this work will be finished as a whole. We must be working together. But we know that we're living in a shaken time. We're living in a time where this is church militant, not church triumphant. And so there will be a shaking in the church. However, those that are surrendering to Christ, yielding to Christ, overcoming sin, spending time in prayer, yielding to the Holy Spirit, beholding the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world, as they day by day surrender to Christ, they will be the ones filled with the Holy Spirit to finish the work, my friends. The Bible says, let's go in the Bible, the book of John. John chapter 1, we see this clearly, that John the Baptist was indeed the voice crying out in the wilderness. He was preaching, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. He was calling sin by its right name. He was pointing also others to Jesus Christ. And John the Baptist is a model for all Christians in these last days who God will use to finish his work. We're in John chapter 1. Notice what the Bible says, we're in the book of John. John chapter 1. And the Bible clearly says in the book of John, chapter 1, and let's look at verse number 19. John chapter 1, verse 19. It says, this is the record of John. And the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, who art thou? See, the priests and the Levites, they did not recognize John the Baptist's ministry. That's why they sent the Jews, the Levites, they sent the Jews to them and asked them, who are you? Because they did not recognize who they were. Isn't that the same thing in the last days? When the church sees men standing up for the word of God, standing up for God's truth in these last days, that many will say, who are you? You are not recognized by our leadership. You're not recognized by our church. It goes on to say in verse number 20, and he answered and he confessed and denied not, but confessed, I am not the Christ. And they asked him, what then? Art thou Elijah? And he saith unto them, I am not. Art thou the prophet? He answered, no. And then said they unto him, who art thou, that we may give an answer to them that sent us, whatsoever thou sayest of thyself. Verse 23 now, John the Baptist confirms he's fulfilling Isaiah chapter 40. He said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Isaiah. So the Bible lets us know that John the Baptist was fulfilling the word. He was a voice crying out in the wilderness. He didn't have a position. He didn't have the recognition of men. They didn't even know who he was. And I just want to encourage someone who may hear this message. Maybe the Lord has laid upon your heart that you need to be doing the work. Maybe the Lord has placed upon your life and your heart that you need to go out and preach the gospel. Maybe the Lord has laid upon your heart to do Bible work, to do some work recognized by God. Maybe man will not recognize it. Maybe man will not encourage it, but God recognizes it. And if you have the power of the Holy Spirit telling you to work for the Lord, I encourage you to go forward and to preach the gospel to every creature. This is how the work is going to be finished. Christ said he's going to cut short his work in righteousness through the power of the Holy Spirit. As we yield to the Holy Spirit's control, God can then use us to spread the gospel to every creature. And John the Baptist was preaching the gospel in the wilderness. The Bible goes on to say that his message was in verse 29. John chapter 1, verse 29, it says, the next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him, and saith, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. And this is the work that Christ wants to accomplish in our hearts. Christ wants to take away sin out of our hearts. This is the work. And when Christ takes away sin, when Christ's work is finished in the sanctuary, when every sin has been confessed and forsaken of, Christ will then leave the sanctuary. His work would have then be finished. It is Christ's desire to take away sin from the lives of his people. And we must, as a people, ask the Lord to help us to forsake sin, to help us to confess and forsake that sin. The Bible says in Proverbs that it says, whosoever confesseth and forsaketh his sin shall have mercy. It's not enough to just confess. God wants us to leave that sin alone. Jesus came to this world because he wants to take away sin. And Matthew chapter 1, verse 21, the Bible says, thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. And as I look at the life of Christ, everything that Christ did, it was because he wanted to take away the sin of the world. For instance, when Christ came to this earth as a child, as a baby, why did he come? He came because he wanted to take away sin. When Christ was studying from his parents, learning at the feet of his mother, learning how to read the scriptures, and spending time in nature, why did he have such a strict homeschool? Why did he have such a strict school and not go to the schools of the Pharisees that taught error? It was because he wanted, his mission was different than the Pharisees and scribes. His mission was, he wants to take away sin. Why did Christ, when he was baptized, why did not he go to them, but instead he went to John the Baptist? Because John the Baptist was preaching the truth. John the Baptist was raising up the standard. John the Baptist was preaching against sin. And also, the Holy Spirit sanctioned John the Baptist's ministry and baptism because Christ himself was baptized and received the unction of the Holy Spirit. All right, let's keep going. Why did Christ reject temptation the way he did? When he said, it is written, because he didn't want to be diverted from his mission, which was to take away sin. His whole lifestyle was thinking about taking away sin from the hearts and minds of his people. This was the whole mission of Christ. This is why he spent time in prayer. Not only because he wanted to keep himself close to the Father, not only because he wanted to be clear of Satan's temptations, but because he wanted to focus on his mission, pray for strength, that by the grace of God he can fulfill his calling, his command, his mission, which was to take away sin, all right? And if you notice, my friend, when Jesus went into the temple, he saw sin in the temple. He saw abominations in the temple. Christ came in there, and he wanted to take away sin, so he turned the tables over, took those things out of the temple, said, this is called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. It was the mindset of the leaders to bring in more sin, but it was the mindset of Christ to take away sin. And all throughout the ministry of Jesus, my friends, I see over and over everything that Jesus taught, whether it be a parable, whether it be a doctrine or a teaching, everything that Jesus did, whether it be long prayers or studying or agonizing with his disciples, everything that Christ did, whether it was a miracle, whether it was a healing, everything that Christ did, even leading up to the cross, when Christ, the Bible says, was bruised for our transgressions. Notice, why was he bruised? For our transgressions. Because he wanted to take away sin. The Bible says that he was, our iniquity was laid upon him. This was the only way that he can take away sin. And brothers and sisters, when we look at Christ upon the cross, where they said he saved others, himself he could not save. It was the only way he can take away sin. And as a result, Christ died for the sins of the world. And by God's grace, if we accept Christ today in our hearts, Christ, guess what he wants to do? He wants to take away sin out of our hearts, my friends. See, this work can never be finished by preaching alone. This work can never be finished by knocking on doors alone. This work can never be finished by prayer lines alone. If the Lord is not finishing his work in our hearts, by us seeing clearly, what are the sins that we love? What are the sins that we are holding on to? What are the sins that are separating us from our Savior? How can Christ take away that sin? It was his very mission to take away sin. And Christ wants to finish this work in our hearts. He wants to finish this work in our lives. When Jesus, let's go in our Bible, to the book of John 17. John 17, the Bible says in the book of John. John chapter 17. We're in the book of John 17. The Bible says that Christ finished the work on earth. He finished the work on earth. And what was the work that he finished while he was on earth? We're in the book of John chapter 17 and verse 4. John 17 verse 4, the Bible says, I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. What was the work of Christ? It was to live every day glorifying the Father. What was the work of Christ? It was to live every day fulfilling the glorification of God, which is the character of God. And until we allow Christ to take away sin and out of our hearts, we can never fully give God glory. We can never fully reveal the character of God to the world. So it is Christ's mission to take away sin. So now that we understand the mission of Christ, which is to take away sin, the Bible says, he will finish his work and he will cut it short in righteousness. And so, brothers and sisters, we must be praying daily that God will help us to behold him, that by beholding him, we may become changed, that the sin that we love, that God can take it away from us and finish his work in the sanctuary. As God's people, we know all the truth. We understand the prophecies. We understand Revelation chapter 13, Daniel chapter 7, the mark of the beast, Babylon, the Antichrist. We understand how the Sabbath was changed. We understand the health message. We understand that God has given us as a church a message that would help us to have sound bodies and minds to prepare for Christ's second coming. We understand the dress reform. We understand all these things that God has given to us. But what good would it be if we don't practice it? What good would it be? And we're told from the spirit of prophecy that truth that is not practiced cannot sanctify the soul. And if we ever know what truth is, it's because we practice it. And as long as we are disobeying God, sin is in the heart, sin is in the life, and God cannot finish his work. Brothers and sisters, you and I are the only ones stopping God from finishing the work in our hearts. You know, I heard someone say, when someone says, God's still working on me, it's simply because we did not allow God to finish the work. Usually when we say God is working on me, we think it's a good thing. But the reason why God is still working on us is because we don't allow God to finish the work. We have not surrendered our hearts and minds to God. We have not given our hearts fully to God. We're not allowing God to use us to the capacity that he wants to use us. There are souls that you can reach that I can never reach. There are people that you can speak to that can be reached with the gospel message that no one else can be reached with. And unless we surrender our hearts to Christ, unless we yield our souls to Jesus, how can God use us in his work? And how can God finish his work in our hearts? There's a work that God wants to do in our lives, and this work will never be finished until we come to God in repentance, until we come to God in surrender and yield our lives fully to God. Let's go in our Bible to the book of 1 Chronicles, chapter 28. 1 Chronicles, chapter 28. I just want to encourage all of us to spend more time praying, to spend more time studying the Word. And when we realize that Jesus spent so much time praying because he wanted to take away sin, that should give us a reason to pray. Why should we pray? Because we want God to take away our sins. Why should we study? We want God to take away our sin. Why should we behold Jesus? Because we want God to take away our sins. That should be the reason. Because we love God, we don't want to break his heart. And sin separates us from God. The Bible says that in Isaiah 58. And we don't want that to come in between us and our Savior. The Bible says in the book of 1 Chronicles, chapter 28. Notice what this powerful Bible verse says. We're going to the book of 1 Chronicles, chapter 28. And notice what the Bible says in 1 Chronicles, chapter 28. The Bible says in 1 Chronicles, chapter 28 and verse 20. 1 Chronicles, chapter 28 and verse 20. The Bible says, and David said to Solomon his son, be strong and be of good courage. And you know, brothers and sisters, if we are going to allow God to finish this work in us, we have to be strong. We have to be of good courage, because we will be talked about, we will be criticized, we'll be looked upon crazy as we try to do the work of the Lord. The devil will try to discourage us, but it says, be strong and be of good courage and do it. Fear not, nor be dismayed, for the Lord thy God, even my God, will be with thee. He will not fail thee, it says, nor forsake thee until thou hast finished all the work for the service of the Lord thy God. God promises that if we would be of good courage, that if we would encourage our souls, as the Bible says, David encouraged himself in the Lord when he was greatly distressed. when we encourage ourselves, when we study his word and pray and claim his promises, confess sin, forsake sin, and ask the Lord to show me the work that he would have me to do. And as I encourage myself in that work, because many will not agree with the work and the calling that God has on your life. But as you're encouraging yourself, the Bible says God will not leave you, and he will not leave you until you finish all the work. My friends, God is trying to encourage us that there's a great work to be done, and we must pray for the unction of the Holy Spirit so that this work can be finished. We need to pray more. We need to study more. We need to believe more. We need to talk faith more so that this work can be finished, not just in the world by what we do by the grace of God through the Holy Spirit, but also by the work being done in our hearts. The more we talk unbelief, the more we talk discouragement, the more we talk anything that will distract from God's word and God's power working inside the human heart, how can God take away sin? If we're cherishing doubts whether we will be forgiven, accepted by God, if we're cherishing discouragement, how can God finish the work? For Christ to finish the work, we must be of good courage. We must be strong in the Lord. And notice what this says here in the Bible. We're going in our Bible to the book of Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9. Brothers and sisters, even Jesus, when he saw that there was a great work to be done, not only in the hearts of men, but there's a great work to be done in our own hearts, and there's a great work to be done in the field. There's a great work to be done, again, in the wilderness, in the field, where no one is working. You know, brothers and sisters, too often I was told that many want to work with the church or work with the conference, but we must go to the fields. There are fields that are empty, brothers and sisters, that God wants his people to go to. The Bible says in the book of Matthew chapter 9 that when Jesus saw the people that had no shepherd, the people that had no shepherd, a field where there was no work being done, Christ, he looked at these people, and his heart was touched with compassion. And notice what the Bible says, Matthew chapter 9, and verse 35, Matthew 9, verse 35, it says, and Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, their churches, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness, every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitude, he was moved with compassion. And because they fainted, it says, because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Verse number 37. Then saith he unto the disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous. The laborers, the workers are few. Pray ye that the Lord of the harvest, that he should send forth laborers into the harvest. So Christ is praying that people, God would send, the Holy Spirit would send laborers into the harvest, fields that are fields where lots of sheep are that are not being worked. God wants those fields to be worked. There must be John the Baptist. There must be willing individuals going forth to proclaim God's message and going forth to share the love of Jesus and also the message for the time, which is the three angels' messages. When people say, well, I don't have the authority, I don't have the permission. Well, the Bible says that Christ gave you permission. Matthew chapter 28, the Bible says in Matthew 28, verse 19, verse 20, it says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things that I commanded you. And it says, lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. We have Christ's commission. We have Christ's permission to go to the fields where the work needs to be finished. And God cannot finish this work unless we cooperate with him, unless we cooperate with him in the finishing of this final work. And who will God use? Again, he will use individuals like John the Baptist, my friends, like John the Baptist. When Christ died upon the cross, as he looked upon his life, all the work that he has done, when he hung upon the cross, one of his last words was, it is finished. It is finished. And that should be the theme of our hearts and minds each and every day before Christ comes, that we will allow God to finish the work in our lives, in our homes, in our hearts, in our communities, wherever the Lord sends us, We must be the ones, by the grace of God, through the Holy Spirit, to obey him in all things and to allow him to finish this work through preaching, teaching, guiding others back to Christ, and also the work of the Holy Spirit in our hearts, cutting that work short in righteousness. It is God's desire that this work will be finished. It is God's desire that this work will be finished. And this work is going to finish by those who are fully surrendered, consecrated to God, so that we can be prepared to meet Jesus, my friend. Notice what the Bible says in the book of John. John chapter 5. We're almost done. I want to give you two more scriptures. John chapter 5. The Bible says in the book of John. John chapter 5. And notice what the Bible says in the book of John. John chapter 5. I'll make sure I give you the right scripture here. But the book of John chapter 5 and verse 36. John chapter 5 and verse 36. The Bible says, "But I have greater witness. I have greater witness than that of John. For the works which the Father had given me to finish, the same works that I do and bear witness of me, that the Father had sent me." And one thing that I noticed is that the more we spend time with God, is the more God will empower us with gifts. The more we spend time with God and give our hearts to God, God will empower us with talents. The more that we spend time with God, God will empower us with his Spirit. And the Bible says, "For we have not the spirit of fear, but the spirit of power, love, and a sound mind." And so the more we spend time with God, he will even take away fears. He will take these things away from us. And Jesus said that the works that he was doing, he was given by the Father. And so if we want to finish this work, God can give us the power and the ability to finish this work. And I want to give you another scripture as we close. John chapter 9. John chapter 9. The Bible says in the book of John. John chapter 9. This is a familiar story of Jesus healing someone whose eyes were blind. And the Bible says he was born blind. And the Bible says that Christ performed this miracle so that his eyes can be open on the Sabbath day. Aren't there many individuals that their eyes need to be open towards the Sabbath day? Aren't there many individuals that their eyes need to be open to the three angels' message? Aren't there many individuals that their eyes need to be open to the health message? Aren't there many individuals that their eyes need to be open to the signs of the times, the mark of the beast, and all these things fulfilling? But most importantly, are there many individuals that need to be open to the love of Jesus, to understand that they have a Savior in the sanctuary pleading for them to overcome sin right now? And once Christ opened the eyes of this blind man, the Bible says he sent him to the pool. He sent him to the pool to wash. He sent him to the pool to get baptized. And aren't these individuals, when their eyes are opened by the Holy Spirit, that they're going to be sent to the pool to get baptized? Oh, yes, they are. But how did Christ heal this man's blind, man's eyes? He took clay from the ground, he spit in the clay, and he put it on his eyes. The clay can represent you and I. We come from the ground. We are formed from the dust of the ground. Man was formed from the dust of the ground. And the water, the saliva that came from Christ's lips represents the Holy Spirit. If we are filled with the Holy Spirit, God can use us to open people's eyes to God's truth, and then they can be sent to be baptized for the Lord. Praise the Lord. And the Bible says in the book of John, chapter 9, that God wants this work to be finished because it is night. It's almost nighttime. It's almost nighttime, meaning in a spiritual sense, probation is closing, and God wants us to finish this work. The Bible says in John chapter 9 and verse number 4, John chapter 9 and verse number 4, it says, "I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work." Brothers and sisters, as we look at the news, as we look at what's happening in prophecy, as we look at what's happening in politics, as we look at what's happening even in the church, we know very clearly that night is almost here, that this world is covered in darkness. The Bible says darkness will cover the earth, and gross darkness the people, Isaiah 60. And so, brothers and sisters, because night is coming, the Bible says let's cast off the works of darkness. Let's put on the marvelous light. Let's put on Christ, our righteousness. Let's believe in him for salvation, and let's put away sin by the grace of God, forsaking every known sin by the grace, by the power of God. And then let's be filled with the Holy Spirit by surrendering, yielding, obeying, trusting, and also pleading for more power so that we can finish this work so God can cut it short in righteousness. So brothers and sisters, as we close, let's pray a prayer in our hearts that God will first finish this work in us. I know that sanctification is a work of a lifetime. It's a work of a lifetime. But brothers and sisters, if we live up to the truth that God gives us day by day, surrender day by day, Christ can finish this work in us very quickly. I believe it. Because God took Enoch out of this world and brought him into heaven. I believe that the reason why God took Enoch out of this world is because God saw that his work was finished. His work in Enoch was done. He surrendered. He yielded. He was filled with the Holy Spirit when he was as close to God as God would have him to be. And also doing the work which Christ had called him to do. His work was finished. And why can't there be Enochs among us today? When we're told, and it's for prophecy, that there are many Enochs among us today. So let us, by the grace of God, make and rededicate our hearts to Christ in commitment so that we can, by God's grace, allow Christ to finish this work in our hearts. Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you for your words. And you said, he that hath begun a good work in you will accomplish it, will perform it to the day of Jesus Christ. Father, we pray that you will please help us to behold Jesus more, that by beholding you, that you will take away the sins out of our hearts, that by beholding you, we may become changed. We may be transformed. And as your Holy Spirit speaks to us individually of the work that you would have us to do, help us, O Lord, to be willing to obey, whether we face opposition, whether we face any type of conflict, help us to be encouraged that we are doing the work the Spirit of God has laid upon us to do. And Lord, I pray in a special way that if anyone on this prayer line is struggling with a specific sin, a habit, a specific addiction, that you will give them freedom in Christ, freedom through your Holy Spirit. Teach them how to surrender the will, the choice over to thee. Teach them how to spend more time in prayer, how to avoid those situations where temptation arises. Give us the strength when we are weak, for the Bible says the Spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Make us strongly pray. Help us to overcome even our bad habits is our prayer. Keep our thoughts in line with thee. We thank you. Use us for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And thank you, Pastor Brett, for that very stirring message. About the blind man, that's one of my favorite stories in the Bible. I just love that story. But I have never heard it applied in such a way. And that was just very eye-opening for me. And the word is like a diamond. You just hold it up, and there's just so many different ways that it reflects. So I appreciate that, and thank you. And if you could share your contact information with our callers and any projects you might be working on, if you're going to be traveling anywhere, for those that would like to come hear you in person, if you could share that with our callers now.
All right. So I praise the Lord for everyone tuning in. My contact information is presenttoheal.com. Presenttoheal.com is presenttoheal.com. There are messages up there as well as some contact information. You can find my YouTube channel through that website as well. Also, I'm on Facebook through Akeem J. Brett. And every single Friday and every Sabbath, I go live. And my videos are on my page. You can find various Bible studies and different sermons. And also, you can, if the Lord has placed upon your heart to send us a donation, you can do so by going to PayPal and typing in our email address. It's presenttoheal, presenttoheal, at gmail.com, and you can there further help further the message by sending your donation there. And right now I'm located in the island of Hawaii. I am about it's 3 hours, 3 o'clock here actually. It's 3 o'clock in the afternoon here. And so there is a time difference, but if the Lord doesn't press upon my heart to travel, I will do so by letting everybody know. And I am doing an event meeting very soon in October, so I ask for everybody's prayers. Those messages will also be recorded, and I will make sure that everyone has access to them when the time comes.
Okay, thank you so much. Please let us know so we can notify our callers as well by putting it on our Facebook page. And we're getting ready to launch a website and at our website as well. And for those that want to hear this message again, share it with a loved one. It's 712-775-7089, same PIN code, 555-145-pound. And this call will be available until our next call tomorrow evening. And I hope I get this name right. It's Pastor Ian Catalico. And for those that are wanting hard copies, CDs of this message, you can send to The Voice of One Crying in the Wilderness, P.O. Box 8441, Laverne, California, 91750, 8441, with a $5 donation for each CD to cover shipping and materials, and make your checks and money orders payable to Vaughn Williams. Those that are seeking prayer requests can email us at our email address, which is avooc2019@gmail.com. You can post it on our Facebook page, or you may text or call Sister Jackie at 773-415-1562. Again, that's 773-415-1562. And I want to take a moment to say thank you to all of our callers on the callback. We want to thank you, all those here across the United States, and for those that are in other countries. We want to thank you for taking time out of your day to hear the message that the Lord has for his people. We want to thank our callers for uniting with us in daily prayers for this ministry and all the ministries connected with it. We want to thank those that have united with us to support our speakers financially on a regular basis or as God provides. And by God's grace, you can now hear us at servingwithamission.com internet radio. And in closing, amid discord and strife, a voice was heard from the wilderness, a voice startling and stern, yet full of hope. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Desire of Ages, page 104. God bless, and we look forward to fellowshipping with everyone again tomorrow evening.